To put into context, in a cubic millimeter of brain tissue, you have something like 100,000 cells connected with 900 million connections. So how the heck do you actually start to parse all that out? You need tools that can get at these extremely dense interconnected networks. And to make things worse, the brain is so high speed, operating at the millisecond timescale, that you have to be able to survey and maybe even control the activity of what's going on there. Just the extreme density, heterogeneity, and high speed of operation of the brain make it pretty much the most complicated thing anybody's trying to analyze right now or fix, as far as I can tell. And that's borne out by its impairments on human health. So over 1 billion people have sought or are seeking some kind of treatment for a brain disorder. Pretty much none of them can be fully cured, and for those that are treatable, the treatments are often partial and have a lot of side effects. And so I think there's just an incredible amount of scientific complexity when you're dealing with this kind of system, where there really aren't any rules or guidelines about how to go about confronting it. Do you go from the top down, zooming in, or do you start from molecules and try to build out? There's really no textbook that tells you this is how you go about solving the brain. I think from an operational standpoint, just dealing with the complexity of all these different fields is a major challenge. So for example, if somebody in my group starts working on a new kind of nanoparticle that might allow us to monitor something very, very intricate inside a living cell, and suddenly we have to go build a new kind of piece of hardware, a scanner, or a microscope that can then receive that information. Oh, and then by the way, the amount of information will be something like the size of the internet every couple days, so now I have to build new kinds of computers to just store the data, much less analyze it. Just the interlocking nature of all the tools is incredibly daunting and part of the fun, of course, as well. So in my group, we work broadly on three classes of technologies. One are technologies that let us read out brain activity at these very, very dense, high-speed scales, new kinds of electrode, new kinds of nanotechnology that lets us broadcast neural activity out of the brain using light, for example. We also work in ways to control the brain. For example, we've been working on tools that have come to be known as optogenetic tools, where we can genetically express a little protein in a cell and then with light turn those cells on or off. And so that's really great because then you can figure out what those cells can initiate or what they're necessary for. But maybe someday you could use these as prosthetics as well, helping fix brain activity when a disease state has caused it to go into an aberrant state. And then finally, we work a lot on sort of accessory technologies, new kinds of computers that can crunch all the data that comes out of the brain. So if you want to record, 1 million cells in a brain, that's a terabit of data per second. So it's like an entire computer hard drive every second. A lot of people like to talk about interdisciplinary research. I like to think of neuroscience as an omnidisciplinary area of research. And that's because there's so many fields of engineering, from chemistry to basic discoveries in biology from half a century ago, to physics, to electronics, that could be applied to the brain. And most fields of engineering have not yet been applied to the brain in any serious way. If we can catalyze more interactions between engineers and scientists that study the brain, that could yield really transformational technologies. So for example, one story from my own life is going back half a century, lots of biologists are very interested in basic science questions about how organisms photosynthesize, how they convert light into energy. Turns out that the intermediate between light and energy, ATP, is actually electricity. And so if you take these molecules and put them into the brain, which is also an electrical computer, you can use those light-sensing molecules that convert light to electricity to control the brain. Light to electricity, electricity to brain computations, and so you can actually use these tools to dial information into the brain, both to study how the brain works and also to try to correct brain disorders. So one thing that I'm trying to help with is this catalyzation of interactions between all these different fields and to bring in nanoparticle chemists and people who work on software to try to make wearable computing applications on smartphones. Can we help those people get into neuroscience?
For more information about the Brain Initiative, visit nsf.gov/brain.